statement by His Excellency Mark Garneau, Minister for Foreign Affairs of Canada. I now give the floor to His Excellency Mark Garneau, Minister for Foreign Affairs of Canada.
Mr. President, Excellencies, before I begin, please allow me to make a personal observation. As I address you, I am conscious that I am speaking to virtually the entire world. In my previous career, I was an astronaut, and I had the opportunity to see the entire world from the vantage point of space. I have flown over all of your countries, and I have reflected a great deal on our planet, Earth. I have realized that Earth is the cradle of all humanity, and that we all come from the same place, and that we have, frankly, nowhere else to go, and that we must find a way to get along with each other, and that we must take care of our planet, a planet that we are visibly damaging. Space offers the unique perspective of seeing beyond one's own national borders. In that sense, this body, the United Nations, offers that same perspective. I am honored to be with you here today on behalf of Canada's newly re-elected government led by Prime Minister Justin Trudeau. I would like to begin my address by respectfully acknowledging that the land on which we gather today is the traditional unceded territory of the Lenape people. Fellow delegates, friends, we are assembled today at one of the most challenging times in generations. The world is facing simultaneous and cascading crises, including climate change, the COVID-19 pandemic, and threats to international peace and security, which serve to exacerbate inequalities, test our resilience, and shine a bright light on the shortcomings of our systems and institutions. But not for the first time has this institution faced such formidable challenges. We must not be querulous or faint-hearted in the face of the hardships and difficulties of our modern world. That's not why we're here. We must learn from the vision and courage of those who have gone before, and we must think of the hopes and aspirations of those who will inherit the world that we leave behind. From the ashes of World War II, our parents and grandparents responded to the unprecedented social and economic collapse of the 1930s and 40s, with its accompanying death and destruction, by building a new international order based on rules and strong international institutions to bring stability, prosperity, and peace for the generations that would follow. They did not wring their hands in despair. They rolled up their sleeves and went to work. Climate change, COVID-19, the rise of authoritarianism and inequality, these are the challenges of our time. They are ours to solve and overcome. In doing so, we must look to the future with optimism. Just as our parents and grandparents stepped up to the challenges of their moment, so too must we recognize and seize our own opportunity to shape the future. Mr. President, there is no more perfect example of where multilateral solutions and political will are needed than in addressing the impact of climate change. Like all of you in this great hall, Canada is not immune to the climate crisis. Earlier this year, the west coast of Canada faced a record-setting heat wave, in some places reaching over 49 degrees Celsius, which saw hundreds of people die and an entire town in the province of British Columbia destroyed. This is our new reality. We know that the world expects leadership from the United Nations. When we attend COP26 this fall, young people around the world will be looking to us to increase our ambition and strengthen global cooperation. We cannot let them down. It is in our hands. In Canada, you have a steadfast and dedicated partner. We are doing our part at home, including putting a price on carbon that will rise to $170 per ton by 2030, and increasing our emissions reduction targets, and also internationally, including recently doubling our climate finance contribution to $5.3 billion over the next 5 years. Monsieur le Président, au fil des générations successives, nous avons travaillé ensemble pour faire évoluer le multilatéralisme afin de répondre à nos besoins, pour l'étendre à de nouveaux domaines et affiner nos anciennes approches. Ensemble, nous avons misé sur l'espoir. Nous avons affronté la peur et innové pour tenter d'améliorer des vies dans le monde entier. C'était compliqué. C'était difficile et c'était souvent lent. Mais le plus souvent, les obstacles ont été surmontés grâce à une combinaison d'ingéniosité et de volonté politique. Cette capacité d'ingéniosité humaine existe toujours. C'est cette volonté politique collective que nous devons raviver. L'avenir est entre nos mains. Sur cette même tribune, certains affirment que la souveraineté nationale est le seul fondement des relations internationales et que c'est là l'objectif essentiel de la Charte. En réponse, je dirais que des défis tels que le changement climatique nous rappellent hors de tout doute qu'une réponse multilatérale reste nécessaire. Les gouvernements qui agissent seuls ne peuvent pas surmonter les problèmes auxquels notre monde est confronté. Nos fondateurs le savaient. Ils l'ont dit et ils l'ont prouvé par leurs actes. The cost of turning inward will be catastrophic for people around the world and only lead to rising inequality. Last year, as all of our governments focused on our domestic response to COVID-19, we moved backwards on meeting some of our sustainable development goals. Extreme poverty spiked for the first time in 3 decades. The pandemic forced us to take stock of growing inequalities within our own societies, with seniors, racialized people, women, the LGBTQ2+ community, and indigenous peoples bearing most of the worst economic slowdown. The pandemic also fanned racism, anti-Semitism, and Islamophobia, and exacerbated inequalities between countries, with the richest among us having speedy access to vaccines while citizens in poorer countries struggle for their health and well-being. We know what must be done. We just need to choose to do it. It is in our hands. In the immediate term, as the pandemic continues to rage in most parts of the world, we must focus on scaling up production and equitable distribution of vaccines, and on the economic reality facing least developed and middle-income countries, such as rising debt levels and liquidity challenges. Addressing these inequalities and fostering a more robust spirit of global solidarity in the face of these daunting challenges reflects not only Canada's values and interests, but also the values and interests of the United Nations. It is in our hands. We know that isolationism also contributes to growing authoritarianism. In the face of the COVID crisis, some have seized opportunities to erode civil liberties, freedom of expression, and other universal human rights. Yet, we do not need to look far back in history to know that politics based on lies, deception, exclusion and inequality creates hardship and pain for people around the world. The spread of systematic misinformation and propaganda on social media and through the internet has made us realize that the digital revolution comes with risks and dangers that we cannot ignore. Canada will continue to stand up and stand firm against the forces of lying and fear, of oppression and hate, of criminality and corruption. For this is fundamentally who we are as Canadians. Our commitments to human rights and the rule of law extends well beyond our shores. Canada will continue its work to promote respect for the rights of people everywhere. For example, we will continue to press for democracy and the rule of law in Myanmar, where the overthrow of the elected government by the Tatmadaw has caused much hardship and suffering to the Myanmari people, and we support all efforts to end the military dictatorship and assure the rights of all peoples of Myanmar, including the Rohingya, whose lives are threatened by a genocidal regime. Canada will continue to lead efforts to maintain judicial independence, media freedom, and the rule of law. We must all continue to fight against impunity. I stand before you to say that this is not something we simply talk about. It is something that we do. 2 days ago, we welcomed back to Canada Michael Kovrig and Michael Spavor, who were imprisoned by the Chinese government after Canada applied both Canadian and international law in response to a request for extradition of a Chinese citizen. Canada observed the rule of law, and two Canadian citizens paid a heavy price for this commitment. We did so as a matter of principle, and we are proud of the courage of our two citizens, the good faith and resilience of their families, and the determination and creativity of our diplomats. We continue to oppose the way these two citizens were treated. And on that, I want to recognize the support of our many international partners in standing with these Canadian citizens, as well as those who helped in developing and signing the Declaration on Arbitrary Detention in State-to-State Relations. Our solidarity in defense of human rights and international law is an important signal. We must continue to stand together, united in our shared determination to defend our values and principles. There is a reason respect for human rights is one of the three pillars of the United Nations. Canada will never forget this experience and this lesson. We shall continue to press for an end to arbitrary detention wherever and however it occurs. Les institutions et les règles que nous avons établies au cours des 76 années d'existence des Nations Unies ont permis des décennies de paix mondiale et de prospérité croissante. Il n'y a pas eu de guerre mondiale. La pauvreté extrême a considérablement reculé. Mais les avantages du multilatéralisme n'ont pas toujours été répartis de manière uniforme et juste. Et le potentiel de paix reste à réaliser dans beaucoup trop d'endroits. Chaque région du monde est affectée par l'instabilité, que ce soit dans les Amériques, au Moyen-Orient, en Afrique, en Ukraine, en Haïti, au Sahel ou en Afghanistan. Et nous manquons beaucoup trop souvent de volonté politique nécessaire pour construire la paix. Je me suis rendu au Moyen-Orient plus tôt cet été et j'ai écouté attentivement les dirigeants israéliens et palestiniens ainsi que des représentants de la société civile. Le Canada reconnaît pleinement le droit d'Israël en tant que membre des Nations Unies de vivre en paix et en sécurité. Nous croyons également qu'une solution à deux États est la meilleure façon de répondre aux besoins et aux préoccupations des Israéliens et des Palestiniens. et nous encourageons des négociations directes pour y arriver. Les conflits, quelle que soit leur géographie ou leur cause, ne sont pas simplement une question de souveraineté nationale. L'insécurité, quelque part, entraîne invariablement l'insécurité ailleurs et nous en payons tous le prix. Les solutions à ces problèmes sont entre nos mains. We know that climate change, food insecurity, and conflict will continue to exacerbate the challenge of forced migration and humanitarian need in the years to come. Make no mistake, this will affect all of us and requires that we address these issues together. The numbers of refugees and other forcibly displaced people are already hitting record highs year after year. We must listen to their voices and give them a place at the table. Humanitarian assistance must keep pace, but should not be viewed as a substitute for addressing the root causes of the problems forcing people to flee in the first place. For our part, through dedicated asylum policies, Canada will also provide refuge for those who put themselves at personal risk by defending democracy and upholding human rights. Canadians are a welcoming people. When we saw the tragedy befalling the Syrian people, Canadians opened their hearts and their homes, bonding together to personally help people rebuild their lives. Where some see risk, we see opportunity. In just a few short years in communities across Canada, Syrians have built businesses, raised their children, and become part of the fabric of our country, just as many other communities did before them. This is Canada's competitive advantage. We welcome people in need, but also understand that their hard work, talents, and cultures enrich us all. Many come to Canada to flee and find a place in which they can not only build a new life, but from which to build a better world. Now faced with a heart-wrenching situation in Afghanistan, Canadians have once again shown their openness to those who do not wish to live under the Taliban rule, but prefer to stand up for democracy, human rights, and gender equality. In fact, Canadians overwhelmingly called on us to do more. And in response to their generosity and welcoming spirit, we have now committed to welcoming 40,000 Afghan refugees to Canada so that they too can contribute to our success while we continue to support their efforts for a more peaceful, tolerant world. Monsieur le Président, notre participation aux Nations Unies s'accompagne d'un engagement en faveur de la liberté, de la vérité et de l'État de droit. Nous avons également la responsabilité de parler au nom de ceux qui ont été marginalisés ou rejetés. Nous sommes fiers des réalisations du Canada en matière d'égalité des sexes, tant au pays qu'à l'étranger. Mais nous ne sommes pas complaisants. Nous continuerons de travailler au Canada pour éliminer les obstacles qui empêchent les femmes de participer pleinement à la main-d'œuvre et notre économie, par exemple en travaillant à donner accès à des services de garde d'enfants abordables à raison de 10 $ par jour à chaque jeune famille au Canada. Une reprise qui ne favorise pas une pleine participation des femmes dans l'économie ne sera pas pleinement réussi. Et à l'échelle internationale, nous continuerons de travailler pour améliorer l'éducation des filles, réduire les mariages précoces et forcés et soutenir les mouvements féministes locaux dans le monde entier. Nous avons également la responsabilité de nous demander des comptes les uns aux autres et à nous-mêmes. Les droits des peuples autochtones ont fait l'objet d'une profonde réflexion nationale au Canada en raison d'une plus grande sensibilisation publique aux échecs du passé et aux défis persistants auxquels sont confrontés les Premières Nations, les Métis et les Inuits. Nous sommes déterminés à poursuivre la voie de la réconciliation et nous savons que le monde entier a les yeux rivés sur nous. Plus tôt cette année, nous avons adopté la Journée nationale de la vérité et de la réconciliation et nous avons fait de la Déclaration des Nations unies sur les droits des peuples autochtones la loi du pays. Le premier ministre Trudeau a chargé chaque membre de son cabinet de le mettre en œuvre. Nous nous sommes également engagés à apporter des changements systémiques en réponse à la tragédie des femmes et des filles autochtones disparues ou assassinées. Nous reconnaissons pleinement les difficultés que les politiques coloniales racistes ont infligées à des générations successives d'Autochtones. Le gouvernement canadien reste pleinement déterminé à protéger les droits des peuples autochtones et à améliorer leur niveau de vie. Colleagues, friends, I am optimistic. We have heard over this past week of the urgent and compounding problems that we face as a global community. We know there is a digital divide, that millions of children have been locked down and locked out of schooling, that pluralism faces a struggle against the forces of extremism and even terrorism, that many are bewildered in the face of the new technologies that can invade our privacy, uproot our families, and change the face of work. But we have solutions and the tools necessary at our disposal. If we listen to each other and bring these critical issues to the center of our work together, we can make progress. It is in our hands. We have a United Nations that over the past year has proven that it is up to the operational challenge of delivering in the most difficult of situations. We have a menu of bold ideas and proven solutions. And here I'd like to thank the Secretary General for putting forward his common agenda, which we must all consider seriously. We know that what must be done. We must marshal the political will to do it. This will require a shift in mindset. It is no secret that we spend too much time talking and not enough time making decisions. Our parents and grandparents rose to the challenge in 1945. Now it's our turn to work together to set the course for a fairer, more just, and sustainable future for us all. It is in our hands. My most distinguished predecessor as foreign minister, Nobel Prize winner Lester Pearson, put it this way, and I quote, "The fact is that to every challenge given by the threat of death and destruction, there has always been the response from free people, it shall not be. By these responses, we have not only saved ourselves, but have ensured our future." End of quote. In this noble effort, you can count on Canada today and in the days and months and years ahead. Thank you very much.
I thank the Minister for Foreign Affairs of Canada for his statement.